Have you ever asked, what is beyond the edge of the universe? And have you ever been told that an infinite universe has no edge? Well, you were told wrong. In a sense, we can define a boundary to an infinite universe, at least mathematically. Although, it turns out that that boundary may be as real or even more real than the universe it contains. Our universe may be infinite. In order to wrap our puny human minds around such a notion, we like to come up with boundaries. For example, we have the observable universe, that patch that we can see and beyond which light has not yet had time to reach us. Its boundary is called the particle horizon. Beyond it, there exists at a minimum thousands and possibly infinitely more regions just as large. Our observable universe is like a tiny patch of land in a vast plain. We define its horizon like we might build a little picket fence around our little patch. Meaningless from the point of view of the plain, but it makes our patch feel more homey and us less crushingly insignificant. We visited these cosmic horizons in one of the early space-time episodes. To review, the particle horizon defines the limit of the visible past. And there's also the cosmic event horizon, defining the limit of the visible future. But these correspond to actual spherical boundaries in space, whose distances can be calculated. How mundane. There's another way to define the boundary of the universe that isn't so shy in the face of an infinite cosmos. In fact, if we twist our human intuition and our mathematics to its limit, we can build our picket fence around an infinite universe. A mathematical boundary at infinity turns out not to just be useful for doing calculations in physics, but may be as real as the physical universe it contains. It may encode that universe as a hologram on its surface. In today's episode, we're going to talk about two ways to define this infinite boundary, and this will set us up finally for laying open the holographic principle. I promise. Let's start with a quick review of types of universe, at least the three basic types described by Einstein's general theory of relativity. The only type of non-infinite universe or closed universe is the one that curves back on itself, like the 3D analog of the 2D surface of a sphere. We call that positive curvature. Travel far enough around, and you get back to where you started. Geometry is a bit broken in such a universe. For example, two parallel lines will eventually converge and cross each other. In general relativity, we call a universe with this geometry de Sitter space, after Dutch astronomer Willem de Sitter. Then there's the flat universe. Classic straightforward geometry, parallel lines, stay parallel, and it goes on forever. In GR, this is Minkowski space, after Hermann Minkowski, teacher and colleague of Albert Einstein. Finally, there's the universe with negative curvature, and the 2D analog of that is the hyperbolic surface, like an infinite saddle or Pringle. In this geometry, parallel lines actually diverge from each other. In GR, this is anti-de Sitter space because it's the opposite of the positive curvature de Sitter space. Terrible name, so we abbreviate it to ADS space. Okay, so two out of three possible universes are infinite. On the other hand, assuming all these types exist, there should be infinitely more people in infinite universes compared to people in non-infinite universes. You're probably one of the former, so let's ignore puny de Sitter space. And for today, assume we're in one of the infinite universes. How do we put bounds on infinity? This all got going in the early 60s when physicists were trying to find ways to map infinite space-time to the edge of an infinite universe or across the event horizon of a black hole. Regular coordinates of space and time are useless there. They blow up to infinity. Physicists found mathematical ways to fuse space and time into new coordinates that suppressed the infinities. We call this process compactification. The first efforts were designed to allow physicists to cross the event horizon of black holes, at least mathematically. We have Kruskal-Szekeres coordinates, Eddington-Finkelstein coordinates, and others. But these coordinates only defeated the artificial infinity, the coordinate singularity of the event horizon, which is also something we've discussed. It was Roger Penrose who defeated the true infinity of an infinitely large universe. In the early 60s, he developed his Penrose coordinates and Penrose diagrams, also known as Penrose-Carter diagrams, for Brandt and Carter, who came up with them at around the same time. We've used them before to understand black hole event horizons, but these were originally conceived to understand the boundaries of the universe. As a quick review, start with a graph of space versus time, a space-time diagram, and then compactify. These horizontal-ish contours are our old time ticks, moments of constant time across the universe, while the vertical-ish lines are set locations in space in only one spatial dimension. The contours bunch up towards the boundaries so that every step on the map covers more and more space and time. The boundaries themselves represent infinite distance and infinite past and future. One amazing thing about the Penrose diagram is that the transformation preserves all internal angles. All angles between intersecting lines relative to each other stay the same. We call such a transformation conformal. And remember that word, it's going to be very, very important. This particular conformal compactification is designed to ensure that the path of every ray of light remains at 45 degrees across the map. That means only light speed paths can hope to reach these boundaries ahead, and only light speed paths can originate from these boundaries behind. Any sub-light speed paths, which means paths of anything with mass, will be swept along with the contours of space. All matter must originate at this point, representing all of space in the infinite past, and must also converge to this point, which represents all of space in the infinite future. Only light speed paths, or in the language of quantum field theory, massless fields, can access these diagonal boundaries. If we write the equations of these fields in Penrose compactified coordinates, then we can do something that seems impossible. We can track a quantum field to infinite distance and calculate its behavior there. That has a very particular use. Penrose diagrams represent a universe that is asymptotically flat. It may have some local curvature due to gravity of massive objects inside, but at its boundaries, the simple rules of non-curved Minkowski space-time apply. That's handy because flat space is the only space where quantum mechanics is fully solvable. The most famous use of this is by Stephen Hawking, as we saw in our Hawking radiation episode. He connected a quantum field between two points at infinite distance, past and future, where he could define the state of the quantum vacuum in solvable flat space. Then he placed a black hole in between these points and calculated how it perturbed the balance of the quantum field traced between those points. He found that two infinitely distant regions could not both be in a perfect vacuum state if a black hole lay between them. He concluded that the black hole must generate particles, Hawking radiation, which, by the way, was a key discovery on the path to the holographic principle, as we've discussed before, and which I'll review again, but not today. Today, we're just talking about boundaries, and we need a very different infinite boundary to give us our hologram. Penrose diagrams define the infinite boundary of a flat universe as a useful tool in calculation. For the holographic principle, we need the infinite boundary of a negatively curved universe, an anti-de Sitter ADS universe. Let's start with another map. Just like the Penrose diagram, we'll do a conformal transformation, all internal angles preserved, and we'll compactify layers towards the edge. But this time, we're not mapping space versus time, we'll just map two dimensions of hyperbolic space. In fact, let's use the most famous conformal compactification of hyperbolic space. That's right, there is a most famous conformal compactification of hyperbolic space, and you've probably seen it. This is M.C. Escher's Circle Limit 4, the final in a series of woodcuts inspired by a projection of the hyperbolic plane called the Poincaré or conformal disk. The basic construction is straightforward enough. Start with a circle, now fill it with a set of circle segments that all intersect the circumference at right angles. Those circle segments represent the straight lines of a hyperbolic geometry projected onto the disk. We can see the hyperbolic behavior of these arcs. They are geodesics, the straightest possible paths in this geometry. Any two paths that are parallel at one point will diverge from each other in either direction. This is a conformal transformation of a hyperbolic surface because the angles of intersection of these lines are preserved, and it's compactified because an infinite hyperbolic surface fits on a finite disk, with lengths represented by shorter and shorter arcs towards the rim. The other feature of a conformal mapping is that shapes are preserved, at least locally. We see that when we fill the circle with a regular choice of circle segments. They define a set of enclosed shapes that vary in size, but not in shape. This is an example of tessellation, tiling a space with regular repeated shapes. Hyperbolic space is fascinating because there are literally infinite ways it can be tessellated with regular polygons. While spheres and flat space each only have a small finite number of possible tessellations. So, this disk can represent an infinite anti-de Sitter universe with two spatial dimensions at a single instant in time. Each tile represents the same size region of space, perhaps our observable universe. The boundary is infinitely far away and looks the same no matter where we travel. If we wanted to represent a 3D ADS universe, we could use a Poincaré ball instead. But the real power of ADS space isn't the cool art you can do with it, at least to physicists. It's the nature of that infinite boundary. Here's a mouthful. The boundary of a conformally compactified anti-de Sitter space is itself a conformally compactified Minkowski space with one fewer dimension. Got it? Cool, we're done here. Okay, let's unpack that. In fact, let's add the dimension of time to our hyperbolic projection. Stack a bunch of Poincaré disks, each representing an instant in time. They give you a cylinder representing ADS space-time with two spatial and one temporal dimensions. Let's call that 2 plus 1 dimensions. On the other hand, the surface of the cylinder has only one dimension of space, the circumference, and the same one dimension of time, 1 plus 1, right? So it turns out that the surface of the cylinder, which exists only in the compactified coordinates of the interior volume, is mathematically exactly a flat Minkowski space. You can extrapolate to any number of extra dimensions, say a 3 plus 1 dimensional Poincaré ball, compactify it so the infinite boundary becomes a surface. That surface is a 2 plus 1 Minkowski plane. And here's the crazy thing. You can treat that surface space and the interior space, also called the bulk, as separate spacetimes with their own physics. But they are connected. Every point on that flat surface maps to a set of paths through the hyperbolic interior. Remember those circle arcs? Patterns on the surface define the structure of the interior. In 1997, Argentinian physicist Juan Maldacena found an incredible correspondence between these two spaces. He realized that if you define a conformal quantum field theory in a 3 plus 1 dimensional Minkowski space, that corresponded to an interesting mathematical structure in the enclosed 4 plus 1D ADS space. That structure looked exactly like a string theory with gravity and everything. This is the ADS-CFT correspondence, some pretty ordinary quantum mechanics in the form of a conformal field theory in one space is a theory of quantum gravity in a space with one higher dimension. the hologram part is because the lower dimensional space can be thought of as an infinitely distant boundary of the higher dimensional space. Every particle, every gravitational effect in the bulk is represented by quantum fields on an infinitely distant surface. Okay, I'm going to have to cut us off here. The deeply abstract relationship between these two spaces needs an entire episode. So stay tuned for the final installment of the holographic principle in the not-so-infinitely distant future of space-time. Last week we enjoyed another potential end of the universe when we talked about the Big Rip, in which space tears itself to shreds on subatomic scales due to the runaway increase in dark energy. Your excitement at our possible doom really showed in the comments. Many of you asked what happens to black holes in the Big Rip, and that's a great question. So I thought that the answer was that black holes would be eroded to nothing. After all, if space is expanding faster than light at the event horizon, that should counter the light speed flow of space into the event horizon, causing the event horizon to shrink and the black hole to dissolve. Some internet physicists do agree with my intuition, but I also read an interesting take by Alan Rominger on Physics Stack Exchange in which he suggests that the shrinking cosmological horizon should merge with the event horizon of black holes to produce a global state where everything just looks like an inflationary spacetime. Chris Hanline wisely notes that dark energy appears to break the conservation of energy. Well, that's sort of true, except that the law of conservation of energy has a very clear range of validity. It's valid in systems that are time symmetric, systems where the global properties of the spacetime don't evolve over time. In fact, conservation of energy comes from this symmetry as revealed by Noether's theorem. However, our universe on its larger scales is not time symmetric. It's expanding, so the past looks very different to the future. In its most familiar form, conservation of energy doesn't apply, and so dark energy can be created from nothing. Now, some have argued that energy is actually conserved and that dark energy is created from the increasing negative potential energy of the cosmic gravitational field. But I think that at this level, it's all just different interpretations of the math. Swalcott asks if the last months in the Big Rip scenario would be a painful and horrible experience for any sentient life still around at that point. Well, it wouldn't be great, that's for sure. After some millions of years watching the galaxies fall apart, the last phase of the destruction of the solar system would happen pretty fast. There's going to be an unpleasant period between the destruction of planet-sized things and the destruction of atom-sized things, where you have the destruction of people-sized things. But I guess the painful part would be when the expansion is fast enough that it starts to disrupt the way chemistry works, without actually ripping matter apart. Our bodies are pretty dependent on chemistry working normally, so there would be some minutes to hours of bad times as our molecules started to betray us. To make matters worse, the Earth would be falling apart at the same time. It's like 2012 meets World War Z meets the Chronicles of Riddick, which by themselves were all pretty painful and horrible experiences. And by the way, guys, I think we just sold a movie.